Thank you very much. Just wanted to know how many of us here knows of this word called selfie. Okay, look around you and look at the average age. No, I'm okay. All right, so I'll take you through that a little bit later. I think something that's been bothering us somewhat since morning is this question. Is there something different about life and times now? And if that were to be true, how do digital technologies change the way claims to justice are made? And how do they alter politics as performance, politics as process, and politics as institutional mechanisms? What I will do is the remit given to me, which is to take us through some of the theoretical work in this area, and also to then problematize if that is adequate, and if indeed it is rooted in some kind of southern discourse, you know, which has also been something that has captured our imaginations in the discussions today. So things that we've heard since morning. So we've heard about connectivity, mobility, interaction, and the group exercises also brought this up repeatedly about the time-space compression. These are words that you find constantly in the literature. Well, so what we're saying is that something is happening that is changing the subjective ontological and the intersubjective social. Now, the last thing that I've written there is not what I'm saying, but the Pope, who is the latest commentator on the internet, is saying. The Pope has said that the internet is the gift of God, and he also says that commercializing communication is the work of the devil incarnate. So that is Pope and capitalism for us. Now, I think what we need to understand are some of the concepts that underlie the space and time question, which recur repeatedly in all the literature, and it also somewhat allows us the new conceptual tools, the new vocabulary to probably theorize, explain, articulate, interrogate, you know, what we feel or what we want to capture about the network society. These are three terms which are territoriality, virtuality, and horizontalism. Horizontalism refers to the increased possibilities for peer-to-peer translocal networking on the internet. Deterritorialization refers to the weakening of the impact of physical distance, which is that if you're Skyping with somebody, then you are really completely disrupting the notion of given notion of space. You are in two places at the same time, which also is associated with the notion of simultaneity. And virtualization is the new opportunities online for temporarily escaping from and probably getting onto the ephemeral or, you know, disembodied, if you will, experience of being on online. So, for those who don't know what a selfie is, this is a selfie. A selfie is a picture that one takes of oneself with one's cell phone. And this is part of the dictionary now. It got into the dictionary in 2012. You know, one of those big and famous dictionaries. I don't know which one, but, you know, the standard ones. And so this is a selfie. Now, there are two views about the selfie. The first one is from Sri Vishwanathan, and those of us who have been here for longer than 40 years, which includes me, know that he is like doddering around 65, 70. And there is Alokita, whose picture you just saw, whose view is below Sri Vishwanathan's view. And why I want us to look at both is to go back to what Sundar said, is to not be uncritical of what we are witnessing. And that I would like to say is for both sides of the coin. We need to be able to interrogate everything that is happening, not necessarily from the standpoint only of classical Marxist-leftist analysis. Neither should we be carried away as pragmatists into this liberal hyper-individualism. What we need to do is take stock of what there is, use the new vocabulary, conceptual tools that we have, and unpack what we have. Okay, so the selfie epidemic is a challenge to storytelling, to pornography, to privacy, to law. Because there was a time when you could say that there is the representation of the other in an objectified way. So us women are deeply offended by that, right? But today, I can take a picture and post it online myself, and that, whether that is moralistic, whether it's right, wrong, good, bad, it complicates the whole discourse of law and pornography. So here, technology transforms the level of the symbolic and the social. The self, as mirrored in perpetual visuals, creates a new idea of the social. Then there was Alokita. Labeling people who take selfies as self-obsessed is going too far. Self-obsessed people are those who think they are the center of the universe. I know many such people, but none of them takes selfies. Those who take selfies are just in love with themselves, and loving oneself is one of the first steps to be confident. Well, do you know this picture?
Yes.
It went viral. Going viral is another vocabulary. Well, this is something that all the glitzy magazines picked up and said that, well, Michelle was not at all happy and she's grumpy because of this open flirtation. Not only was this commented upon as open flirtation, it was also held that Obama should not have taken this picture in Nelson Mandela's funeral. So, one of the commentators that I read actually said, this compulsive addiction that some of the groups pointed out to documentation, self-documentation, is something that not even President Obama is free from. Okay? So those are David Cameron, and the lady is the Danish Prime Minister, I don't know her name. So has politics changed? Yes. It's not just about vocabulary. The social discourse of politics now emerges through networked pathways that are more diffuse, adaptive, and decentralized. And I think Jasmine's presentation was actually indicative, illustrative of that, which is that there is a certain way in which politics develops, you know, in a pure online way, as we shall see, in combinations of offline, online way, and even purely offline ways implicated by the internet. Politics seems to be everywhere. So what does a very leading feminist commentator have to say about this? Today's vibrant, young, unruly movements that throng together over one issue and then move on again before analysts can catch them are not negotiating, nor seeking to build institutional stability. They're on the streets, in the piazzas, blogging, tweeting, texting, performing, meeting on Facebook and YouTube. The size, the energy, the multiple images and words in so many languages hardly allow you to catch your breath. Now, the most important thing she says is in the end, this type of civic action, she doesn't comment on whether this is good or bad, but what she says is, this type of civic action provides possibilities for new alternatives. So she leaves a question open as to what are those contingent conditions which will determine what will actually emerge out of this kind of unruliness. So what do we see around us that makes us believe that indeed politics is much more diffuse? So you find people, especially for, you know, some of the discussions we had in the morning about hyper-individualism and Urvashi's comment that it creates the political subject, it does politicize an individual. I mean, why do we see that polarity? It's because if we actually paused and thought about Burma, for instance, you know, activism in Burma, most of them are actually sitting across the border in Thailand. And some of our friends in the organization who work with these people actually say that the safest space for these people is the internet of Thailand. So within Thailand, the Burmese activists actually have a safe harbor. And this can actually be said to be true of many, many communities who have, even the East Timorean, you know, democratic movement, you know, which used the internet and subsequently, of course, used many other devices. And so going back to the vexed question of Egypt, it has also allowed movements to inform, organize, mobilize. Now, one very important thing which we have done in the organization is to really study the Egypt question long and hard. Now, the thing is that it's not as if the internet caused the Egyptian revolution, But it is certainly true that the internet had a very important role to play in it. This is, for me, the analogy to this is, as a feminist, is very, very close to the analogy of education, which had come up yesterday again, which is, what does, you know, education have to do with social outcomes, social justice, rights, etc.? But we actually have concrete evidence, and this is one of my favorite examples, that when people actually noticed that in 2001 census, suddenly the literacy rates for women in India had jumped up inexplicably, they wondered what had happened. I mean, the schools were as terrible as ever in the past decade. And, you know, there were still infrastructural issues. The communities were still against, girls going to school. But what they discovered was, in the decade of the 80s and 90s, a lot of women's movements had actually, on the ground, set up these collectivities of women who then realized, or for whom an important aspiration and a connotation of social justice was, that they would certainly send their daughters to school. So it was a completely non-linear attribution. So mothers in these collectives actually thought that it was important for them to send their daughters to school. And therefore, in the 1991, this is actually documented in the EPW. So it's a very, very solidly argued case. Similar results are seen in terms of non-linear attributions to women in Panchayati Raj. We know that it's a big joke that women are made to sit there and then men are actually running the whole system. But it has been found by MIT in one of their researches, which really took into consideration very strong research methodology, including control factors and such, that in the villages where women were sarpanches, the age at marriage for girls went up. Just role modeling. People are seeing women sarpanches. Something is happening at the socio-psychological level that our French friend was trying to tell us about, that something happens and that cannot be discounted, because politics is also not just rational, right? It's also affective. So we really need to also look at that. So in the Egyptian case, what's really important is, in the entire decade of the 90s, they were very, very influential. A position about it becomes transformed into an ideological individual. Then there is a very interesting thing about meso spaces, you know, between the macro and the micro, the in-between spaces that take birth in liberal democracies. And this is very important. One of the research studies that we supported and is part of the network of researchers that we work with found that in the Philippines, just before the Reproductive Rights Bill was passed in the parliament year before last, we encouraged a lot of activists in a slum community in Manila to start blogging and talking to the policymakers about what it meant to them to have that reproductive law, rights law. Which basically is to say, you know, we live in this filth, we don't have drinking water, we really don't, you know, have livelihoods. So what does this particular law and legislation mean in a highly Catholicized society? Of course, I mean, we don't really know what this little exercise that we did, you know, whether it really contributed to the overall politics. But one thing it did, for each of those women and men and people of other genders in that community, it certainly transformed them into political beings. When they wrote the blogs, there was something they were able to do, you know, tell their stories, etc. And this is an in-between space. They would, it's not the street protest, which they don't have time to go to many times. And neither is it a kind of joining in, you know, all Philippine alliance and, you know, lobbying with the government. It's an in-between space, and these in-between spaces become extremely important. I would also like to talk about things that maybe Kiran and others know very well, and constantly we have to live in this fear that if we antagonize the US, they will cut off the internet, you know, which is also to say that a lot of groups have used this in both ways, in negative and positive ways, the denial of service attacks, which are to suspend or slow down a network so that they are not, that network or that system is not able to carry out its communications. Similarly, you have hackathons for a cause. You have mass texting or tweeting to galvanize flash mobs. Now, these are not done in an isolated way. Nobody, for the pleasure of it, takes something and, you know, galvanizes. I mean, that is, again, we need to think critically. The fact is that the people who have cell phones and the people who take selfies may be the same people who actually decide that in Malaysia, fair elections is an extremely important agenda, and therefore support organizations and back them in large numbers by flooding malls, by flooding public spaces like gardens, just by deciding that 10 a.m. Sunday, just be there and say, we want fair elections. And this movement is documented very well. It has a Wikipedia entry. It's called Bersih. And Bersih has many versions. It started in 2003 and then subsequently 2009. And so the movement for political transformation in Malaysia continues, and tweeting and galvanizing flash mobs is a very, very central strategy to what they do. Okay, so these practices across a wide spectrum, from the self-discovery of political subjecthood and a bonding with communities of faith to exercising active citizenship, endow the project of politics with immeasurable possibilities, I would still say possibilities, for seeking new paths to justice. The question remains, what are the conditions under which these may be realized? Now coming to an important question that came up in the previous section. Does noise count? If we ask Kanchan and her book, we know that the most important thing that people have said, even in the Habermasian context, is that men have always shouted, never allow women to shout. But there were people to listen to them, right? So, the question is not that there is voice and there is noise. But the question is, does noise count? So the question has to also be answered that much more than communicative power, or in addition to communicative power, there may be other factors, politically speaking, including maybe material wealth, the fact that you are the biggest business house in the country, or the fact that you are the telecoms giant and you're going to colonize the rest of Africa, whatever it is. Or that you're the Catholic Church and you're too powerful, or that you're the next PM and you're the Hindutva guy, and whatever. But noise is always counted, so why should we be dismissive of noise? We should actually have a critical theory around noise, but I think what is noise and whether it counts is an important question. So this is the sixth diagram. I think we had five representations. This is an artistic installation which looks at the network. I have to rush, I think. I have 20 minutes or so. Okay. So I'm going to take you very quickly through a few theoretical submissions, each of which I think is very illuminating, and I personally find them educative. So what does game theory say? Game theory says that through digital technologies, there's a leap of faith. And the leap of faith happens because a known becomes a known known. This is what NKSS did in India, right? They said, on the muster rolls, you have people for whom you are supposed to have made payments under the NREGS. Now, the very fact that the name of people along with payments made is put up on the village wall counts, because a known becomes a known known. And this particular contagion of a known becoming a known known becoming a known 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 is what happens in the performance of politics in this particular manner, which allows you to show that you're not alone in a particular set of beliefs. Consequently, a dispersed and anarchic performance of politics, which is very similar to what has already been commented upon by a feminist political scientist, who talks about these as those moments in time when people abandon their routines, and suddenly, because of a certain common assumption you see around you, you start inventing new ways of doing things. These moments may not last. As we know, the Egyptian revolution has not necessarily left a trail of extremely democratic events, but they punctuate history and they become part of history. What does Castells say? Castells talks about, of course, his histology is very famous, and that was the rise of the network society, the power of identity, and the end of millennium. these three books are really, very, very influential in this arena. So new social structure and process, which is ensured by information and communication technologies based on microelectronics, which is the network society. And he says, in a network society, it's with the help of computer networks that information is created, processed, transmitted, building on the knowledge accumulated in the network hubs. He talks about hubs and he talks about nodes. Hubs are more important than the nodes, and hubs are where the power is centralized. So this goes back to a point that Sundar made in the morning, the self and the other, said Sundar. So the self and the net, so you're constantly having this dialectic. So there is the net and there is the self. There is Bruno Latour, who is another very influential sociologist. His work is in the area of science and technology studies, and he is the founding father of the actor network theory, one of the most influential theories in network society field. And he says that philosophers have been rather unfairly preoccupied with the question of existentialism, to be. So he says we have to start looking at the verb to have. According to the actor network theory, action that is radically distributed is the network. And what he does is, I think, really brilliant. In the digital world, where both the aggregate and the individual are identifiable and you can retrace back and forth, he says that a new way of conceptualizing the social can come about. In fact, he says, and one of his most favorite takes is against Durkheim, and he says that we are all given to thinking about social theories, and for 200 years we'll talk about, agency structure, individual society, and we've not really exercised our imagination to go beyond. So he says, I have stopped using the word social and I only use the word collective, because he says there is a possibility today that between the aggregate and the individual you can repeatedly do a back and forth in a discontinuous way, and that potentially allows you to reimagine what should be an ethical basis for society in an extremely de novo way. So this is what he says, so I'll just leave it here. Then there is the Danish-American political sociologist, Saskia Sassen, who talks about three properties of digital networks: decentralized access, distributed outcomes, simultaneity, and interconnectivity. And she says, all these three things have produced two different kinds of outcomes. In the case of global financial markets, it's allowed for centralization of power, and in the case of the global justice movements, it is actually allowed for decentralization of power. So she's making a very important value-laden observation here, that in and of itself, the attributes of network society in terms of virtuality, deterritorialization, horizontalism, simultaneity, and whatever else, are not good or bad. The way they can be mobilized, the way these attributes can be mobilized, is what is the clinching thing. So, from the theories quickly, there is attention to spatial scale. Scale becomes very important today. I mean, the fact is that we are all, there was this thing about touch and body. We are all at one and the same time having a global span, although we are embodied, embedded individuals. And then I spoke about the other three things. So these are actually examples that none of the systems we actually give examples of, like the Wikipedia, as intrinsically decentralized are necessarily so, So this example here is that there is certainly an editorial board sitting there which decides what is to be done or not. It also says that this entire illusory thought, and this is actually from something that Morozov has written, this thought that Occupy movement or anybody else, the greatest, gift of our times, that you can actually have leaderless movements, I don't think it should be celebrated, because the fact also is that if you have leaderless movements, then they can be incoherent. So somewhere, even though Blank Noise could be seen as a project which is highly decentered, I would like to ask the question, which is a counterfactual: would Blank Noise exist without Just Me? So there are three concepts that I'd like to actually say is a contribution of our organization in understanding social justice and citizenship. which is, there are three things: place making, sense making, and claims making. Now, each of these three things actually changes in some way because of network society. So first is placemaking, how are identities produced in a network age. So there is globality, about which I spoke about. The most important thing we didn't talk about is the fluidities between the public and private. Always, feminist scholars have held that the public and private are more rhetorical devices. There is always this fluidity. But in this networked age, the way in which publics and privates are constructed are very location specific. I have to give you the example of migrant workers. This is again a research project that we supported, where in Hong Kong and Taiwan, migrant women workers who are in isolated workplaces, which are private households. But the private households are the public workspaces of domestic workers. They meet every weekend in Hong Kong in public parks as a private community. And it is their mobile phone which allows them to mobilize the public and private in a very flexible way as and when is needed. So we can actually give innumerable examples of this, you know, use of public and private in an extremely fluid way because of offline and online possibilities. But places continue to matter. Because of the weight of the major centers, one very interesting question Saskia Sassen asks us is, have you seen, just because there are many more financial centers today and Bangalore is part of the map, does that diminish the importance of Mumbai or London or New York? No. So there is some material basis to capitalism and nation states continue to matter. The second is sense making. What happens to sense making? Old meanings are giving way to new ones. And the most brilliant thing that's been, that I think we should really look at is, social justice is now not just a concept, it's a conception. It is something that people can, in their own ways, articulate. The possibility that they can articulate it. There is a new political syntax. You know, I spoke about hackathon and flash mob and all of that. Dismantling authoritarianism and consumerism through counter-discourse. I tried to actually look for it, but it seems like there is some problem and it's not there in the ALF website anymore. People have done, it's like graffiti. You know, a lot of online parody, you know, if you regularly look at YouTube, you know, about the Chinese government, there'll be lots of things, you know, about our own political parties, innumerable things that are actually doing the rounds if you only were part of those circles. And so it's actually possible to joke about things much more and that way influence politics. Also, there is this entire meta-narratives. I think one of the examples that was given in the morning was how, and this is also talked about in the Egyptian revolution, that what was tweeted by an activist was really closely watched and picked up by the mainstream media. So there is now the possibility that at a very micro level, you can shape the meta-narrative. And very interestingly, there are new rituals. Like, I really find many of the rituals that you spoke about just mean, you know, the things that you connect online and then subsequently meet at a particular place. You know, all of that is possible because of the new kinds of sense-making. But who is shaping meaning? We've been discussing this since yesterday. In the times of Web 3.0, there's behavioral advertising, there's personalization, what's called intelligent searches. So the Google will show up if I put the same word differently for you and differently for me, because Google believes that it knows about me more than I know about myself. And there is always-on connectivity and depoliticization. In, for instance, one of the think pieces that we commissioned talks about how in Hong Kong, everyone is pro-gender equality. Everyone is a subject in the university. In a certain sense, that always-on thing is what we discussed is also possibly desensitizing. Okay, I think there is something that has gotten truncated because okay, this is about claims making and, you know, the different ways by which people can make claims. And I think we've already talked about it in terms of people having a voice, people able to organize, etc. But the most important thing is that, unfortunately, activists lack the capacity for system integration. One interesting thing Saskia Sassen says is that as much as financial centers are decentralized, these are also heavily centralized in the sense of system integration. Without having that power, they can't expand. Because you have to, at the end of the day, when the stock exchange closes, you have to aggregate everything in New York, right? And you have to be able to do that precisely. And you have to. And if your system's shut down, then you're done for. So in that sense, the system integration capacities for claims making of activists, of people seeking social justice, even if they have access to media and technologies, is actually quite weak. The other thing is the new actors and new constellations. It's quite difficult for actors in the political space seeking social justice to make sense of the maps, the ever-evolving maps of people in power. I mean, these constellations are really fluid and really moving, and that's really problematic because it's part of the neoliberal global economic architecture. And the last, which is very, very critical, is that politics today is embedded in the market. So if you're using Facebook to organize, be sure that if you really started ruffling the feathers of the government, then the government can ask Facebook to shut your account down. And this kind of thing is not uncommon, it happens all the time. So I'm going to end here by saying, you're going to do this manifesto exercise, and I just wanted to clarify that to Murli, that it's not that we wanted to end in a kind of a manifesto exercise. I look at each step, you know, every session, every conversation here is important, and that is just one of the things that we want to do, and it's not really a culmination of things. I think some of these things are really important. One is the question of authenticity. Since everyone can potentially be a political subject, who is the real political subject? Then there is the polarization versus deliberation issue. Deliberation is whatever she said. You can actually talk, you can actually dialogue. And some people say, no, there is echo chamber, you know. If you are going up and signing up only for those e-magazines, e-lists that you sympathize with, then you're only dialoguing within a particular set of converted people. Then there is this thing about the selfie, right? Today, if you look at the next generation, I mean, I'm looking at my own daughters, for them, interruptions are not, they're not aware that interruptions are disruptions. I mean, they don't look at texting and then talking and then suddenly switching on the television and then all of that, that discontinuity somehow suspends the ability to be self-reflexive. Again, there are fragments of micro-power in the social justice arena, but macro-power is strong. But all this fluidity, how does it then end up in institutional coherence? That's an open question. Then there is this mobiles rhetoric. You know, everyone is using mobiles and therefore a great new world is possible. But we have a case of decentralization of communicative power without necessarily a democratization. And similarly, horizontalism also calls on the other hand for coherence. Then there is this entire issue of online voting. You know, you vote and you go back home or you just shut down your laptop. So there is representation. There is representative politics, but without the burdens of direct democracy. And then to frame all of this is the post-welfare neoliberal state, which is making matters extremely difficult. So there are structures of exclusion. And then there is the most important question, which made Sundar extremely popular this morning, which was the publicness of the internet. The internet is a public space, but what does it take to keep it public in the sense of people controlled, you know, not surveilled by the state, not controlled by capitalism? Okay, I want to end with this. Students of philosophy, tell me who this is. Yes, Rodin's thinker. Okay, so philosophy, a domain for men. This is the Tinkerers by an artist who did this in 2008. And I somehow feel, and you can ask anybody, any woman in the room, I feel this is much more intuitive. I have seen many more women sit like this than men. And what I think is profoundly moving about this subversion is that this was a model that was first done on the computer. Then it was printed in a 3D computer, a 3D printer with plaster of Paris, and then the artist did a rubber model of it, and then finally, you know, used paint and such things. Of course, by there would have been many female sculptresses who could have thought of this and done this, But the fact is that the internet has made this subversion possible. And it's an extremely material depiction of the subversion. I want to tell you that. It's not happening online, right? So what may we conclude? This is one possible set of conclusions. That communicative power in the network age can be potentially game-changing, but it's one resource in network politics. Social justice and the shift in democracy it presupposes will continue to be a wider social institutional struggle. It also depends on the material conditions that transform civic imagination, civic sensibility, and civic intelligence. It also calls for a repoliticization of informational and communicative realms, casting the digital as very much intrinsic, very endogenous to democracy. I am ending with this because the Pope also said that the internet is a gift of God and it should not just lead to interaction, it should lead to encounters. So I thought that was quite nice. It's not really interesting. Thank you.
Thanks to Anita Gurumurthy for this wonderful talk. We have about 20 minutes